you got anything in to play with right now.
I'm gonna do this. Hey.
Hey.
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm all right. What's settled in?
Yeah, I'm sitting. What, do you know where we're gonna be sitting?
Up here. So let me get I need some name cards.
The other name tags are actually supposed to be.
Yeah, I can pull them around or flip them over.
So this doesn't come with faces.
I'm gonna pull these up. So that's okay. Thanks that Pete and all the other guys are in.
Let's see if that pulls it.
Will that help? Look at you. Coming in with a invention.
Well, the name has kind of faces.
Are you the famous Jason?
Well, it all depends. I am. Very nice to meet you. Good way to put a face with a name.
Out. we'll talk later. I know you're
Nydia.
Good evening. All right. Thank you all for coming out tonight for the first debate of the 2016 cycle for Forsyth County. And we have the first debate is Commission District 4. And we have with us Commissioner Cindy Jones Mills. And we also, go ahead. And also on stage is Kelli Warren. Moderator for today is Mr. Joel Natt. Joel is a longtime member of the Forsyth County Republican Party, a member of the 7th District Republican Party, as well as the State Party, and serves on the Board of Elections for Forsyth County. So thank you, Joel, for being here tonight and serving as our moderator. Before we go over the rules and the format of the debate, I would like for everyone to stand and let's do the Pledge of Allegiance. Schedule with everyone. So we have the Commission District 4 starting right now, and then followed by Commission District 5. And then on Monday, April 25th, a week from today, we have School Board District 3 and School Board District 5. And then on the 27th of April, on Wednesday, April 27th, we have the coroner and the sheriff's debate. So please mark those on your calendar. All those debates will be right here in this building. And so we look forward to having you back for those debates. Right quick, I'm gonna try to read this from my phone. So the selection of the questions was determined by a flip of a coin. And Joel will go over that in just a second, who came out, who's going to be getting the first question. The order of the speakers will rotate back and forth. And then each opening and closing statements, we have 2 minutes for opening and 2 minutes for closing. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer each question and 1 minute for rebuttal. And then the candidates will also have a chance to ask a 30-second question and with a 30 seconds to ask one question, and the opposing candidate will have 2 minutes to answer that question. So without that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Natt to get the debate started.
Good evening. Before we begin, I do have one request of everyone in the audience. Please mute or silence your phones out of respect for the two candidates. We flipped a coin earlier. Ms. Warren won. She will start. She will get 2 minutes to introduce herself. And Commissioner Mills will follow. Ms. Warner will be the first question of the evening. Well, Ms. Warren, you'll need to unmute your mic. Your 2 minutes begins when you're ready.
Thank you. Good evening. And first, I would like to thank the Forsyth Republican Party for organizing and hosting these debates. I think it's very important for the citizens to be able to be informed of their choices before they go to the polls. And I appreciate all of you that have taken the time out of your schedule to be here. So my name is Kelli Warren, and I have been a Forsyth resident for 20 years. My husband and I live in the Preserve at Etowah in the northwest corner in the middle of nowhere in Forsyth County. We raised both of our daughters here, and I now have grandchildren here in the county as well. I am a former teacher. My husband's a retired police officer. And I have decided to run for commissioner because I care about Forsyth. I chose to move here, and I want to see the rural quality of life that we chose to move here for. I want to see that preserved. Right now we're at a fork in the road, and I feel like that we are at a crucial point in decisions that are being made of what direction our county is going to go and where it's going to be in 20 years. So I'm very excited. I would like to be a part of those decisions, and that is why I'm running for District 4 Commissioner.
Ms. Phillips.
Good evening. I'm Commissioner Cindy J. Mills, and I want to thank the GOP for hosting this debate, and I want to thank each of you for attending, and I want to thank the voters of District 4 for allowing me the privilege to serve for a little over 3 years as their commissioner. Our pastor's sermon yesterday was on what do you do with the opportunities God has given you? And I thought about that in relation to my service as the District 4 commissioner. North Forsyth has been blessed with many things this past 3 years. Transportation, the 400 widening to 369, a new interchange at exit 369, the 369 widening and intersection improvements at Hammond's Crossing and Coal Mountain, two new parks at Matt and Lanier Land, North Forsyth school improvements, the Chestatee notebooks that were $45,000, the North Forsyth back entrance for $189,000, the Forsyth County Drug Awareness Council, the Five Summits one that's going to be tomorrow night, the Mentor Me Reach To Scholarship Program, the Forsyth Keep Litter Free campaign, the Beautification 400 exit ramps, all while answering emails to all the residents of Forsyth County that were in my district and not in my district. Many great things have been accomplished, but there's still so many things that need to be done. There's many things that can't be fixed overnight. I'm dedicated to finding the balance and the solution between a growing population and maintaining the high quality of life that Forsyth County residents cherish so deeply. My experience and the relationships I have built while I've been in office are necessary to get us where we need to be. That's why I need to be reelected, and that's why I'm asking for your vote on May the 24th.
Fine. Thank you. For everybody's benefit, up in the front row, we will be keeping track of time. You'll see a green card for 1 minute, a yellow card be held up when they each have 30 seconds, and a red card when their time has expired. Ms. Warner, the first question is to you this evening. Forsyth County has been cited as amongst the fastest growing counties in the state. Specifically, what type of growth do you support and what type of growth do you not support?
Okay, well, I support growth. What I don't support is growth that is happening before the infrastructure is in place to support the growth. I guess the term is smart growth. But this county is going to continue to grow, and people are going to come here. But we have to make the right decisions so that people can get places on the roads and that the students can be in classes in seats, not in trailers. So those things need to be addressed, and addressed before it happens. It's happened in other counties, it's happened in other places, it can happen here if we work together.
You have to understand how processes work, and people have to understand the difference between if you run for Board of Commissioner or if you run for the school board, because the school board has processes that take place with the way the state funds school board or the school system. And they are required to have 125% over capacity before the state will fund them. And I mean, a lot of people, I mean, like school impact fees, they'd be wonderful to have, and people would love to have those, but that requires a state constitution change. And while our state senator Michael Williams tried to get that done, he was unable to do that. I mean, I think he's still going to keep working at that. I mean, that's why we have decided to update the comp plan many years before it was time to redo it, because in order to zone property, that you go by the UDC. So, I mean, once that plan represents the taxpayer's vision and that plan can be changed, then the commissioners can vote according to that plan. So, with the taxpayers will get engaged in that and they can change to that new plan this year. Hopefully, they will all become engaged and then they can make changes to that plan. And then that plan can be adopted and the commissioners can make changes with that plan and get a plan that each community wants to see adopted to their community that fits their needs.
You may rebuttal.
Okay.
Any rebuttal? Okay, moving on. Staying on infrastructure. What do you see as the most, Commissioner Mills, you were first up on this, sorry. What do you see as the most pressing need for the county in terms of infrastructure?
It's transportation always, but the $200 million bond is helping tremendously, but we've got to get those roads built. Secondly, in North Forsyth, sewer is huge. I mean, we've got, right now it's piecemealed. I mean, in Northeast Forsyth, there's just no sewer whatsoever. I mean, you've got a little piece at Hampton. You've got another little piece with the city of Cumming that's accessing it. You've got Fowler that's on the west side. It's very complicated. Right now, we've got a sewer freeze in North Forsyth that I put on just a few weeks ago with the other commissioners. That's a very complex thing right now. You've got 14,000 lots that were zoned back in the mid-2000s, between 2002 and 2006, that we've got to deal with. I mean, that's a huge problem. There's actually a lot of roads in North Forsyth that have no water. They're still on well water. So that's another huge need that's in North Forsyth. You've got in other areas, I mean, you've got a lot of sewer that's still got to be paid for. Before people start talking about wanting to cut off all growth, you've got to have a lot of thought that goes into how are you going to pay back all the sewer debt. That's something else that's got to be highly considered. How are you going to pay back that debt if you get under 2 units per acre? Who's going to pay for that debt?
Warren?
Okay.
What do you see as the most pressing need for the counties in terms of infrastructure?
I feel that the roads are definitely a problem, and that's the infrastructure that we need to focus on updating and getting it where it needs to be. The schools are a very big concern. I feel like we could work together with the Board of Education. The Board of Education would ask for, or they can ask for, a moratorium on certain building, to allow the schools to catch up to where they are. Even though they're building the new schools, and there's going to be more seats, but when those schools open, they're going to already be at capacity. So we've got to do a little bit of control on how many students are coming in, and we can do that through controlling the buildings in the residential areas.
My only rebuttal is that, I mean, we've had a moratorium the past 2 months, but you've got to think about, and moratoriums are fine, they have to be substantiated legally. But when you sit down and you start talking to the school system about moratoriums, I mean, by the same token, you got to think about how you're going to pay for things. Moratoriums are all fine and good, but the school system, by the same token, how are you going to pay for your schools as well? How are you going to pay for anything? I mean, you've got to be able to balance things. Balance is the key to things. You've got all this kind of debt for schools, debt for your roads, debt for your sewer, and at the end of the day, all debt has to be paid. And you can shut down all the things you want to shut down, but you've got to pay for things. And ultimately, everything falls back on people to pay.
The rebuttal.
I agree. I mean, the money has to come from, and it's coming from the taxpayers. And I'm not saying to stop all building. I'm talking about high density building. We can still build on larger lots, which is going to allow people to move in, but there will be less impact on schools if we do it that way. So we're still, you know, we still have the residual from that.
I believe, the next question is to you, Commissioner. What do you believe needs to happen with the current water rights issue between the county and the city?
Ooh, that's a good one. So much of that is out of our hands. I mean, it ultimately, if it were a perfect world, we would be able to, I mean, you look at population, I mean, the county is 212,000 now, and the city's population is 5,000. And I mean, but ultimately the city has the straw, and we don't have the control over to take that straw away. So until we have the control, I mean, we don't have the authority to take that away, and the other agencies do. So until that happens, we can't get anybody to say that power can be taken away. So we buy what we buy. We have to deal with what we have to deal with. We've not been able to get the allocations changed. And even at a bigger scale, we've got the water wars that are going on. And we've got the water on the federal level. And so we can't get a conversation even to happen because of the water wars. And as long as that's going on, and it looks like that's not going to be resolved anytime soon, we have been at the mercy of even the bigger happening between Georgia, Florida, and Alabama. So we've been at the mercy of the bigger picture, and that's been going on for quite some time.
I agree that we are at the mercy of the city as it stands right now. And the county doesn't have an option of having a straw in the water, which means the city is our only access of having water. So we're paying them, you know, that's where we're getting our water. I think that we could probably negotiate a little more with the city, work closely together with them to give us a little more leeway in the decision making on that. But you're right. I mean, we do need to work with the other powers that be to try to move forward and get our own straw as the county so we can be water independent and not be dependent on the city of Cumming for 100% of our water access.
First, I owe you an apology, Ms. Warner. I did two questions to Commissioner.
Absolutely okay.
But the next question is to you.
Okay.
Based on the present county budget, where would you increase or decrease allocation of funds for county services?
Well, the sheriff's office is 2/3 of the budget, I believe, or a good size of it. Maybe not 2/3, but it's a large part of it. I would look at some areas in there to be able to cut down, maybe privatize some of those areas. That are connected so far, like the jail. There's some things that could probably be privatized there and cut down. I mean, I would have to look at it line by line, and I am not, you know, I don't have the exposure to that right now as just a citizen running. So, you know, I'm sure that with help from consultants and so forth that I would have available to me as a commissioner, we could come up with reasonable cuts in different areas.
Budget's tough. I mean, I've been on finance committee since I've got on board, and we did a real rollback last year, which we did use the help of the sheriff to get that there. I happened to be the one to call on him to get him to cut $2 million to get to the rollback And I was expecting all these pats on the back and praise, and there wasn't one person that even noticed, and I was so disappointed. I thought surely we'd get something, and we didn't. But there was also, because of the transportation bond, there was an increase, and then the school system had an increase, so I don't think many people noticed. I do think that we're going to need to privatize some. We had a facilities report that came in last week during the work session that showed in the next 5 to 25 years, the county was growing so much and that the budget was growing, the facilities would have to grow so much that there was going to be the need of 80-something million dollars of growth in facilities, which was staggering. That didn't include land. And so that, to me, says we're going to need to privatize. That seemed astronomical. I think that other cities and municipalities seem to privatize. I think planning department needs to privatize. I think we can look at different other areas that we could perform more efficiently and privatize. I think that anytime you grow with a courthouse and a new jail, that there are things that you're going to have to do to look at how you can be more efficient and operate from in a private manner. I think that anytime that you've got a population that's growing the way it's growing, that your budget's going to have some increases too. Another thing that's really killing our budget is the healthcare cost as well.
In fairness, and since I asked her two questions, I will go trying to get. What would you support privatizing of county services and why?
What would I support?
Yes, and why?
Well, like I said, some of the services that are in the jail, the food vending, maybe medical services. I mean, I'm sure there's a variety of other things that I would privatize, but things that I feel would be more effectively handled by outside entities that we wouldn't have to do through the county. That's what I would privatize.
Anytime you start mentioning privatizing, everybody that works in the county that does those jobs gets really upset when you start talking privatizing. So you would have to look at that very carefully and do some types of study to see if it would work out to privatize. I say that because I'm not trying to take away anybody's jobs. I think you would need to look at each department and then do a study to see if it would behoove the county to privatize. In saying that, you could look at, like in the planning department, you could look at the inspection department. Right now it's really hard for us to hire because construction's come back so strong. It's hard for us to hire plumbers. It's hard for us to hire all those different jobs because construction's come back so strong. That might be some of the jobs that we might could privatize. It could be some of the other jobs, some of the other fields we could look at might be some of the different positions that could work would be in that. I do think in the sheriff's office, the food is something that we do privatize already. Medical, I think, is what we do privatize already in the sheriff's office as well. But some of the different departments could be, you know, things that we do offer could be some of the things that we could look at privatizing some of the areas that we don't already in our tax assessors. You know, it could be that some of the things that we do could be, we could look at other municipalities that privatize and are able to do that through maybe our road department from different things.
New Republic. Moving on. What is your position on the creation of any additional cities within the county? I'm trying to reset back. So,
okay.
So you gave me one more.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
Should explain that. She's going to go.
So I'm just me and them?
Yeah.
Okay.
My apologies.
Sorry.
What is your position on the creation of any additional cities within the county and why?
Well, I mean, the way I see it is if there's a group of people that live in a certain area and they want to make a change, they should be able to have the choice to make that change. They should be able to vote on it and make the decision about that. That gets in a lot of complicated areas, as we know, because we've just gone through all this with the Sharon Springs. But I do feel that the people need to be able to have a voice and be able to express it, and that it shouldn't be decided by the higher power, so to speak, about what works best for their area and their community. So, talk about it.
I feel that it all depends upon the cost to the taxpayers. I think that if somebody wants to have a city, then they need to pay for that city. I think that if, and they need to give, it needs to be a fair and accurate portrayal. If it needs, if they want to have that city, then there needs to be studies, needs to be conducted that shows a fair and accurate portrayal of that city on both sides of the equation. It doesn't need to be on, it doesn't need to be a study that's done that shows just one side of it. It needs to show, if it's going to be done, it needs to show how it's going to affect everyone, not just the people that it benefits, not just the people that wants for it to happen. It needs to show, if it's going to be done, it needs to show how it's going to affect the people in North Forsyth, how it's going to affect those people and their taxes, how the people in District 4 is going to affect their tax bill. Not just the people that want for it to happen in District 2, but the people that are going to be paying for it in District 4. They need to know. They need to know how it will affect them. They need to know if their parks that they are paying for, that they have paid for in that $80 million bond or $100 million bond might go away. They need to know how it will affect. They need to know the whole picture. And they need to know if it's going to be a city light, that it's really going to be a city light. Or they need to know if it's going to be a full city. They need to be told the truth. That's all they need to know is the full truth, not just a portion of the truth, not just the truth that somebody wants to tell.
No, I agree that the city should have to be self-sufficient. I agree. But who's to say that there might not be other areas of the county down the road that want to, maybe there's an area North Forsyth that would want to become a city as well. I just feel like it is something that, again, you know, it's our constitutional rights to vote and make a choice and have a voice in our community.
I never said I wanted to take away anybody's constitutional right. I'm all for anything to do with the Constitution. I just want the whole truth to be told, every bit of it from both sides.
Next question is to you, Commissioner. How will you work with the law enforcement to eliminate the trafficking and distribution of drugs in our county?
That's a great question for me, because since day one I got into office, I think it was January 20-something, I called Sheriff Piper and asked him for us to have a meeting. I got everybody in the courts. I got our school system. I got nonprofits, everybody I could think of around the table, and we formed the Forsyth County Drug Awareness Council. And we actually found out there was a false drug council that had been taking $1.2 million from the federal government. We had those people arrested because they were under the guise of a Taekwondo business. They've been doing it illegally. We've been having tomorrow night's our fifth drug summit. Everybody's invited to come to the conference center. We've been trying to raise drug awareness prevention. We've now got our own SAMHSA grant, and we've got our own person hired, and we've been trying to raise drug awareness in every way possible. The sheriff started a CHAMPS program and a TIP program, and all of that came from our Drug Awareness Council. We've tried to be at the forefront every way we could to raise awareness for drugs in Forsyth County, and I think we've been a shining light, and I'm very proud of it, very proud of championing that for our county. I'm proud of our efforts.
The first thing I would do, I would increase the number of officers that are strictly for drug enforcement in the Sheriff's Department. From what I understand, there's, I think, 3 or 4, and there definitely needs to be more than that. We also need resource officers at the schools that are truly in touch with what's going on with the kids in the school and that are trusted by the kids. The drug issue runs deep, and I've seen it myself as a teacher. I've had friends in my family tell me that it's easier to buy heroin than it is to buy cold medicine at CVS. So it's a serious problem, and we really need to, as a community, parents, teachers, leaders in the community, and sheriff's office, all be focused on this and addressing it, and not just forming groups here and there, and we really need to be getting down to the root of it.
Just invite everybody to come to our 5th Drug Summit tomorrow night. Thank you for your support.
Any rebuttal? The next question is to you, Ms. Warner. What is your definition of quality of life, and how can it be preserved within Forsyth County?
Definition of quality of life. Quality of life is different for different people, but I feel like in District 4, the quality of life there is a rural quality of life, and it's a little slower and quieter and beautiful, and that is why the majority of people that live there have either stayed there because they, you know, were born here, or they've moved there because they chose to move there because of it. So quality of life is, in D4, is just that. It's a rural quality, and I feel like the majority of people want to maintain that as part of our community.
Quality of life is such a subjective term. I think through working through the schools, especially when I was working with the drug awareness, I started realizing that a lot about the drug awareness had to do with prevention, and I started working up at Chestertee Elementary and with prevention because of it being a Title I school. And in working at Chestertee, I realized there was a whole lot of kids, especially when the schools went to being not doing makeup days, and I realized there was over 200 kids that needed laptops. And my dad, and Tommy Bagel combined with $45,000 to get those kids some notebooks. And quality of life there was trying to provide a level playing field for those kids to have education, and trying to get an after-school program with Mentor Me so those kids could have the same education as other kids. And working with the school system to try to get broadband and different things to provide more opportunities. I mean, 80 kids don't have food over the weekend. So working with actually Lambert and different people to bring in food on the weekend for those kids. So quality of life for those people are different than South Forsyth. And so there's just a lot of different quality of life issues in North Forsyth than there is for other parts of the county that have to be looked at differently.
I know, I agree that there are kids that are in need of, you know, missing meals, and
they have less than others, but I don't think it's necessarily just in D4. I think we have, there's issues countywide. I mean, we have other issues in around, we have other Title I schools, not just in D4. So I feel like it's a countywide thing that we all need to address.
Well, I run for District 4.
Next question relates to a ballot question that's being proposed. What is your position on countywide voting for all commissioners? Yes.
I strongly, strongly support district-wide voting. I've lived here all my life, 54 years, and I've been here at a time where Commissioner Laughinghouse ran, I think he ran 3 years and didn't carry District 1 one time. I was here when other commissioners, I mean, when it got to the point where Lake Forest is the most sought after subdivision in District 4, has the strongest voting block, strongest voting percentage in our district, I think. And the last time people were elected, I mean, for District 4 countywide, the commissioner running didn't even show up for the meet and greet there. And it was simply because Lake Forest didn't matter, because you could win countywide and not even go to Lake Forest, because you could go to the 4 or 5 precincts that mattered in south part of the county and you could win. You could go to Old Atlanta and you could go to Sharon Forks and you could go to those, and nowhere mattered in District 4. And that was the simple, hard truth. You could, it got to the point where you could take your little bags and you could put a rock in it and you could put and throw out in those neighborhoods, and that's all that mattered. And it got to the point where District 4 no longer mattered. And so people didn't even campaign or ask for people to vote in District 4. And so I don't want District 4 not to matter. I don't want people not to campaign in District 4. So I strongly, strongly support district voting, and I will fight for district voting for District 4.
All right.
I do not, I support countywide voting, or at least a countywide voting, and then having maybe one at large. And the reason being is that the Board of Commissioners sit and meet and make decisions about the entire county. And we are one Forsyth. We are not South Forsyth, North Forsyth. We need to be making decisions that affect the entire county. And I feel like that's the best way to do it. I just think that we need to be doing countywide voting so that everyone has a choice about the 5 people that are making the decisions that affect their lives day in and day out.
What is your vision of the county looking like in 10 years?
Well, I can, the county or my district? the
well,
county?
Well, you could interpret it either way.
Okay, well, the south part of the county is probably going to look just like it does right now, because there's really nowhere else to build or put anything down there. 10 years from now, I would like to see District 4 with more homes. I mean, definitely going to have growth. There's no doubt about that. But I'd like to see more of the neighborhoods that were built back in the late 90s and the early 2000s that were street cut and not clear cut. Neighborhoods like Walnut Grove, where I moved in, and that was the first thing that attracted my husband and I to that neighborhood, was that the trees were all there. There were 260 homes in there, but the trees were there, and the topography of the land still existed. It was beautiful, it still is. I would like to see more neighborhoods like that, like Lake Forest, the neighborhood I'm in right now, Preserve It at all. But those were custom builders, and they were street cut, and I feel like those are the kind of neighborhoods that people moved up there for that reason, and we need to continue to offer what we've advertised. So that's what I'd like to see in the north end of the county.
I would like to see North Forsyth have a vision, whatever the vision that the citizens would like to have. I would like to see just citizen input. I would like to see Todd Jones, that is running for state representative, shared with me a great vision that he had seen through his travels. He's traveled so much more than I have, and he wrote in to me and as a concerned citizen and came and shared his vision with me, and I consider him a friend, and he gave me a great idea about a sub-area plan that he said it was too late for South Forsyth, but it was a great vision for North Forsyth, and it was a trail system that you could put in, and it would take the Big Creek Greenway, and as it expands into North Forsyth, it would encourage a trail system sort of to go east to west, and it would have spurs that would come off of the trail system, and it would take our natural resources and it would highlight those, because we have beautiful natural resources in North Forsyth, that it would highlight those, and it would take the lake, and it would highlight the lake over to Sawney Mountain, and Sawney Mountain over to Matt Community Park, and Matt Community Park over to the Etowah, and that to me would be ideal if we could do that and make it all flow and work together. And his idea is part of what the sub-area is all about. And it's if it can come together and you can take the development and make the development nodes come off of that, I think it's perfect for the millennials and the seniors. And if the citizens buy into that and want to incorporate that, I think it's got a way of being really beautiful and working together.
In reference to the sub-area plan, I'm not against trails, I'm not against any of that, but my concern is that the description of it was that there would be high density areas that were similar to the Atlanta Beltline. It was in the paper and it was quoted by Vanessa. So areas would be, that says high density to me when I hear Atlanta Beltline. So I'm hearing some high density, and I'm hearing shopping areas connected to this and that. If it was simply just trails, not a problem. But I don't think that that's exactly what the plan is.
That was tough. That's totally not true. And Vanessa said she didn't quote that to anybody, and it was misquoted and not true. And then it was totally mischaracterized on Facebook and totally not true. And no plan has been adopted. Nothing about Atlanta Beltline was anywhere a part of that whatsoever.
Hey, next question. All elected officials are expected to bring accountability, integrity, and common sense to government. Please give examples of how you plan to do all that over the next 4 years. I believe your first.
Take that.
All elected officials are expected to bring accountability, integrity, and common sense to government. Please give examples of where you will accomplish that in the next 4 years, if elected, obviously. All elected officials are expected to bring accountability, integrity, and common sense to government. Please provide examples or give examples of where you plan to do that over the next 4 years, if, in your case, reelected, in your case, elected.
Well, in your oath of office, when you put your hand on the Bible, you are expected to do that in your oath and your code of ethic and everything that you profess to do. Not just in your oath, but then also you have in your government forms that you do in your zoning, You have, a lot of people don't realize that when you have affidavits that you sign with your zonings that come before you. You have conflict waivers, you have all different other things that are transparency documents. You have things that, if you have conflicts that you have to, if you have people that, when they put in for zonings, if they've given you any money in your campaign, they have to disclose that. You have things that if you have a conflict, if you, affidavits that if you own property and that you have to sign. There's also a code of ethics, you know, I guess it's what you're asking. I'm trying to think of anything.
Free the question, ma'am.
If there is any other, and then you have your personal moral code of ethics that you have that come forward, that you have anything that you feel like Ken Gerard has a thing that he says out of an abundance of caution, you know, that you come forward and you recuse on anything that you think is morally or unethical that you should recuse on. And you come forward and you recuse on anything that, I mean, I had one item that I recused on a piece of property that I had sold a year or two before that I didn't have to recuse on because there was nothing that bound me to recuse on, but I did just out of an abundance of caution to recuse on. I think is where you were going on the question.
As I said, I just read it.
Could you read it one more time?
I'll do my best. All elected officials are expected to bring accountability, integrity, and common sense to government. Please provide examples of where you will do that if you are elected.
Well, first of all, as I qualified as a Republican, so I am a fiscal conservative, I will make sure that when I am making decisions that I am looking out for the taxpayers' pocketbook and not those of special interest. So that will be my first and foremost question is, how is this going to affect the taxpayers? How is this going to affect the citizens here? And I won't allow myself to be influenced by any special interest groups when I'm making decisions. And I mean, that's how I'll be transparent. I'm sure that I will make some, I'll make some mistakes just like anybody else would, but I would do my very best to do what's in the best interest of the taxpayers, and that would be what I would base everything on, is that.
Twelfth question of the debate, and the last before we go into a wrap, a few yes-nos. Being this is a Republican debate, who did you support for the presidential preference primary? And if they are not the nominee, who will you vote for? Will you vote for the nominee in November, and why or why not? It is to Ms. Warren first.
I voted for Cruz. I mean, probably anybody that knows me knows I voted for Cruz. And whoever is nominated, I will vote for. If it ends up being Trump, I will vote for Trump. If it ends up being Cruz, I'll vote for Cruz. If they do some crazy thing up there in July and come up with another candidate, then I would vote for that person too. So, yes.
I voted for Rubio, but I will vote for the Republican nominee.
We have two yes no rapid fire questions. First one is to you, Commissioner. Do you support do you support changing property tax laws changing property tax laws affecting senior citizens for school tax exemptions? It's a Democratic ballot question that has been asked.
Is it taking away their exemption?
Yes, it is.
No, I would not want to take away their exemption.
No, I would not take away their exemption.
Do you believe the county should consider insourcing the county attorney? And you're the first to that one, I'm sorry.
So you mean like hire the...
Bring it in-house instead of having it with Mr. Gerard's practice.
I think it would probably be more, I think it would be more economical to do that.
No.
Okay. We now go to the final section. You're each entitled to ask your opponent one question. And since you got the first question, she gets to ask the...
Okay.
You get to ask the first question of your opponent.
I don't have a question to ask her.
I do have a question for you. I want to know why, when impact fees were proposed back in 2013, why they continue to be kicked down the road, so to speak, or postponed and not implemented until just a couple of weeks ago.
When they were proposed in 2013, they went out to a consultant. The consultant didn't come back to us until 2014. It took them, I don't have the exact dates in front of me, but the consultant didn't come back to the committee for quite a little time. I mean, I'd have to get the exact dates. But when they came back to the committee back last year, they came back and there was a, in fact, I do have, because Commissioner Levent sent something out in error today, and I do have some of those dates to correct he and Mr. DeMaria's email that they went out. I am glad I do have these dates. When they came back in to the committee, they came out with a number that was like $9,000 that they went out. But they failed when they came out with that number. That number that went out to the public that they were going to charge was, it included a large number for transportation. But in that number that they put out, they failed to account for the $200 million transportation bond or House Bill 170, the transportation bill. Well, we had a meeting and Doug Diller came in, a really high-powered attorney, along with other people that said, if you put out that, we're going to sue your county because you can't charge that because that number's erroneous. And if not only are we going to sue your county, but we're going to make you pay the lawyer fees and everything else. So we went back to the consultant and also the impact fee committee went back and met again. I'm out of time.
Your first for your closing remarks. You already told 2 minutes for closing.
Thank you so much for tonight, for coming to this meeting. I want to encourage each of you to become involved in the comprehensive plan because there is so much more that needs to be done. The comp plan will represent the people of District 4 and of the county. It will represent your vision of what the citizens of each of the district wants. And it will, whoever the commissioners are that are elected, it will determine what they decide this county will look like in the future, what each of your communities will turn out to be. Even though I've only voted on 5 residential zonings since I've been in office in District 4, there's so much more that needs to be done in the future. We need to rethink the 14,000 lots that were zoned in the early to mid 2000s. We need to develop an overlay plan with architectural design standards. We need to complete our subarea plan that showcases our natural resources of North Forsyth with a trail system that attracts both millennials and seniors alike. We need to all work together to find solutions to bridge gaps and divides and find ways to maintain who we are and to become even better in the future. I want to follow the Constitution, and mainly I want to listen to each of you. I want to thank God for giving me the opportunity to serve you and for putting all the things together that so much could have been accomplished for District 4 and for the future of Forsyth County. For I know that it's been through His grace that all of this has been made possible. I want to thank you for allowing me to serve you these past few years. Thank you so much.
Okay, I want to thank everyone for listening to us and being here to participate. Thank you to my family who has been putting up with me for the last few months, and my friends, and all the support I've been getting from all of you. Being a county commissioner is a representative position of service and leadership, and not a position of dictatorship. And I feel like the decisions need to be based on the best interest of the taxpayer and not motivated by individuals or personal agendas. As a fiscal conservative, I will base my decisions on those values and in the best interest of the taxpayer's pocketbook. When you go to the polls to cast your vote, I ask you to consider, who do you trust? Who do you trust to make decisions that are in your best interest and that are values equal of yours? I ask for your vote on May 24th. Thank you.
Let's give the candidates a round of applause again. In this debate. That concludes District 4 for the debate of District 4. We have District 5 coming up. That'll start at 7:30. We just want to take a few minutes to let everybody take a break and get things changed over, and we'll get started with that one. Thank you.
How are you?